the impala all have plenty of delicious grass to eat. Those baboons will be eating seeds, bits of pieces of fresh shoots. They'll be pulling up the grass roots. Isn't that cute? They'll be pulling up the grass roots and eating the rhizomes and the stolons, which are like little sort of mini tubers, if you like. They'll be eating grubs. And investigating underneath logs, biting scorpions. Robin, I think the key is that it's not possible. You say, if we were to walk like a baboon, would the animals in the impala be less scared of us? You mean on all fours? I'd like to try it, you know. Seriously, I wouldn't mind trying it. I think I'm going to do it right now. But yes, I do think it would make a slight difference for a while. The problem is, though, we don't walk on all fours very effectively, and I imagine we'll still look like human beings. It's worth a try, though. So, Robin, next time I'm on bushwalk, I will try and approach some impala on all fours. That's actually a brilliant idea. I've never thought of it before. So, yeah, let's try it out and see if it works. That will be very cool. Look at the little one there. And I don't know if you can hear the bleh, 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 bleh. What that is the mothers actually calling their babies. I used to think for quite a long time that it was the baby impalas calling their mums, but it's the other way around. And there's such a vast herd of them here. Oh, it's gorgeous. And I'm sure you're all agreeing with me that it is the most sweet thing to see. Such a tiny little group. Tiny little baboon, sorry. Huge group of impala, all making their way down towards the waterhole. Oh, nice one, Justin, and I don't really know the answer. You say, which human age group would I put a baboon's age at? So, you know, if we were to put an adult baboon's intelligence, at what human age would I put that at? Well, it's quite interesting because you're basically asking, as a chimpanzee seems to be able to achieve the cognitive abilities of a 5-year-old human being, you're wondering about the baboon. I'd say probably no more than 2. But remember, they're intelligent in ways that we won't ever understand and in the ways that we are not. So although, yes, it might not be able to understand language any more effectively than a 2-year-old human being can, what we can say is that they have vast intelligence in other ways. That's so cute. There we go. Oh, she lost her baby there. Yes. It's a good point there, Larry. You say you reckon that the impala will smell me before they'll see me. And I think you're probably right, Larry. I will try and find some baboon cologne. As disgusting as that is, a baboon is not a pleasant smelling creature, I must just tell you. Baboons are not pleasant smelling because they tend to dung around where they are and they don't really mind the smell, so they walk in it and pick it up and throw it at each other, and it's all rather vile. What are you alarm calling at? Tell me that Karula is walking behind us on the damn wall. Roger. You say you are looking for a baboon. Sorry, I'm just just wondering what they're alarming at. Hang on a second. Madam Leopard. Here we go. They're looking directly behind us, Brian.
Yeah.
No, we can't see behind us, of course, on account of the rain cover. What are they looking at? The baboons are not even vaguely reacting. Some of the impala over there are not even vaguely reacting. It might be at us. But I mean, we've been sat here for so long. Well, that's very strange. Anyway, while we wait and see what's going on, Roger, you say you're looking for a baboon that's nursing a hangover on account of the fact that they have thieved beer from Jamie and Brent. Well, I might reckon that there are a lot of baboons around the Sabi Sand that have very high alcohol tolerances. They are excellent thieves. They are the sort of street gangs of the wilderness, if you like, where the lions are the more executive mafioso type. The baboons are the sort of street gangs, and they are excellent at sort of petty crimes. They break into all sorts of places, steal booze at will, and I mean, lots of them take malaria tablets, contraceptive tablets. They take all sorts of tablets because they all taste quite sugary, you see. And so they're quite heavy drug takers. I mean, there is a drug problem in the street gangs that frequent this area, Roger. Let's go a little bit forward. Mainly because I want to turn around and just see if I'm not missing something. I don't think so. Guess they just saw her ears popping up here and thought maybe. But certainly they didn't all react. Unless. No, man. Oh, they're still doing it. Alright, I'm going to try and understand what's going on here. While we do that, Taylor is still in her tent. Let's go and find out what she has.
I've changed. I'm no longer Taylor. I've got the face of a baboon now. But look how big its teeth are. And well, it's something that you really wouldn't want to end on the bad side of, because I can promise you, and I'm going to turn it sideways so you can actually see, that if you get into a fight with a big male baboon, I reckon you're probably going to come off second best. I would rather face off a male lion than face off an angry baboon that has lost its fear for humans. And I'm talking about a wild lion, I'm not a lion that is captive and hasn't got a fear for humans, because then you'd probably also be in a lot of trouble. But even though a lion is big and scary, so is the baboon, and with teeth of over 2 inches long, you can imagine when they are upset and when they're having territorial disputes with other baboons, or maybe other vervet monkeys, because they often get into disputes with them, they will lift the front of their gums, lift them up and expose those big teeth, and sometimes even open their mouths and do a big, big yawn. Now, baboons are incredibly intelligent animals, and I don't think we really understand anything about the communication with animals. We just only understand a very, very small amount, but the scientists reckon that baboons can communicate in over 30 different ways. So that's including all vocalizations and then also the other vocalizations, not non-vocal, sort of big screams and shouts and all those types of things. But of course, like I said, the yawning, just the lifting of the gums and exposing the front teeth, and also the lip clappering. They do that to each other as well, and they all mean all different types of things. And If you've never seen a baboon before, perhaps you've really only just started watching Safari Live. We'd love to hear from you, so you can hashtag Safari Live on Twitter with any of the questions, or if you just have any good pictures that you want to share with us that you've sort of taken screenshots of the show, you're welcome to do that. And you might not know this about baboons if you have just started watching, but they are omnivores, so they don't just eat the fruits or the flower buds or the new sprigs of grass coming out of the ground at this time of the year, and we haven't seen it yet, but I suspect it won't be for too long now, especially as we're seeing all those baboons starting to circle and hang around the impala, which they normally do, safety in numbers. But every now and then a baboon gets the taste for something, and it's normally something like a little impala or even a common dacre, a steenbok, something like that. They need to eat bits of protein. They will even feed on other monkeys. I've seen a baboon feeding on a vervet monkey before, which was horrifying, but they do that. So, and that's something that I struggle to understand, because you see baboons, like you just saw with James. James very, very happily moving around together, feeding together on the long grass. But in the same breath, and this time of the year, in the lambing season, they turn themselves completely around and they will snatch up a young impala. I think that is quite spectacular. Now, we've got lots of other things in here, and seeing as though we're on the topic of teeth, I have a question for you. Whose teeth are these? So you can send your questions and your answers through. So your answers through to hashtag Safari Live or questions@wildearth.tv if you only have an email address. And I'd love to know whose teeth are these. It's actually quite easy, because there's not many animals out here that have a teeth like this. And it's a tooth from an animal, or teeth. One, two, three, four and a half teeth of an animal that we've been seeing. Well, I've been seeing quite regularly now. I'll give you a clue. They're quite large, but that's it. So earlier on today, Eggsy was saying he felt something hard growing. I think it's a stump or something growing out of the tent. And I sort of just stood on it and then almost fell over. Can you imagine if I'd fallen over and completely knocked down the whole of James's display? I'd actually just have to pack my bags and just walk to Gowrie Gate, because James would never let me back here again. It'd be a disaster. Right, now it seems as though the clouds have disappeared, which is quite nice. We might be in for a sunset. So let's just take a moment to just appreciate the beautiful sky that we have out here. Isn't that lovely? A couple of big dark grey clouds still, but the sun has definitely pushed through and burnt a lot of them away. Eggsy, what are we doing next? Eggsy's got no idea. He's got no inspiration to that. No, I feel like I'm using a lot of paper now. We won't use a lot of paper. Rightio. Well, I'm going to do something out here on this board for you, but we're going to shoot back across to James now, and I'm not sure what he's got because I've been out in the tent and I can't see.
Well, that is the back end of something we don't see very often these days. I'm going to just reverse. It's the most beautiful light here, just below quarantine clearings. The sun is beginning to set. We thought maybe there was a leopard slinking through here, so we're waiting to see if she doesn't cross the road in front of us. But there, everybody, one of the rarest species of the Sabi sand, a wildebeest. Bull on his own, spending time with his new friends, the Nyalas. This is the first wildebeest I've seen in many moons. Well, not quite many moons, but in a long time. And I think he's quite special, on account of the fact that I haven't seen many of him. Isn't that nice? Look at the light, isn't it gorgeous? All the tall bottlebrush grass there. Cetaria sphacelata. Glistening in the sun, some guinea grass just behind his bottom in the background. And a gentle wind blowing up from the south, and I wonder if it didn't carry with it the scent of predator, and maybe that is what made those impala go. I'm pretty sure that this wind is bringing in some more weather, but that's okay. We've had the most gorgeous afternoon. Seen lots and lots of different things. Impalas and baboons and nyalas and wildebeest and leopards. There we are. He's very pleased to see us, this fellow. He's not vaguely nervous of us, which is always the best. And I love seeing them in amongst the flowers there too, every so often. A little bit of pink from the sesame. Oh, it's beautiful. And the smell is so fresh because we've had that rain. Oh, what have you seen? What have you seen, my friend? Old buddy, old pal. No, I think he just heard an impala going bow behind us. It's all the impala are very chilled to the max. I can see them behind me, drinking at the pan. You can probably go to the dam cam to see them if you want to. What are you looking at, Nyala? Now, if this thing gives a bark, if that gives an alarm bark, then we'll know. Reese, not here. Certainly I've heard of it happening. You say, do animal trackers here ever disguise themselves to smell like animals? Do they ever roll in elephant dung, for example, and then go tracking? No, they don't. You certainly read about it, especially old school kind of stories of the early settlers that were after ivory. They would roll themselves in elephant dung and then walk along. It would certainly not be a bad idea, because they do obviously have very sensitive noses, the animals out here, and they don't like the smell of human being whatsoever. And they pick it up very quickly. Just the other thing on that note, and I think it's one something that we should talk about and try and investigate together, that is that I'm just not convinced of how smelly predators are to their prey. And we've heard lots and read lots of stories about how predators like... We're going to carry on down the road. Of how predators like to head into the wind if they're hunting. So they'll turn and they'll face their noses into the wind and go hunting in one direction. That's how they start off doing it, so that their prey doesn't smell them. And I just don't buy it. I've not noticed it to be something that happens all the time. And I think it's because they have a very, very... indistinct smell. I think it's possibly one of the reasons leopards roll in buffalo dung, and lions often roll in hippo dung, like we saw Tinyo doing this morning. Wasn't Tinyo, it was Nsuko or Nena rolling around in hippo dung with Jamie this morning. And I think that's because they're trying to disguise their smell, and I don't think they smell very strong. So let's watch. The next time we watch those Nkuhumas get up at dusk and start heading off on the hunt, we figure out if they're walking into the wind or not. And we need to obviously do a number of samples to find out what the story is. But you know what? The wind blows almost universally from the southeast here. And you'd imagine, therefore, that if they always headed off into the wind, that eventually all the predators of the Sabi sand would end up concentrated on the southeast corner, which obviously they don't. I suppose that's a fairly simplistic view of things, but it is possible. Hello, Lemonade. What a very cheerful, summery Twitter handle you have. Lemonade. Doesn't it make you feel like a child again, Brian? Yes, Lemonade. I've completely forgotten your question. It was something about Nyala horns. No. Yes, it was about Nyala horns. Okay, I'm going to need a bit more than that. Right, why are they twisted? Okay, there we go. They're twisted largely, I think, for decoration. Now, that might sound like a terrible answer to a fairly, well, what would seem to be a biological question, but I think it's a peacock's tail situation. The usefulness of let's go to their cousins. Their most obvious cousins are the kudu. Now the kudu have got long spiraling horns. They are almost entirely useless for defense against predators. A much straighter rapier-like horn would be much more effective. A spiraled horn in thick bush is actually something of a huge hindrance if you're trying to get away and stay away from predators and run away from them. And so I think what it does is it advertises the fact that despite the obvious kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? Hindrance. The obvious hindrance formed by those horns, they're still able to get away from predators, and I think that's why they have impressive spiraled long horns. Let's just have a quick look at that male impala. I was hoping Karula might have come across here. We're heading back towards those little babies, and babies, they're 11 months old. We'll just have another look at them before sundown. There they go. See if Mum hasn't come back to fetch him. Slinky, secretive lady that she is. No, nothing just yet. Something gave a Franklin a big fright. We'll just get round the corner here. I don't see anything. I have a strong feeling about this, but maybe it's just a feeling of a want rather than actual premonition. Ah, very nice. We're in the air, everybody, so let's head across back to the dam where Connor is standing by and Taylor's going to tell you what he can see.
We've got looking at the drone shot over here, all the beautiful impala. Oh, look at them run. Look at them bounding about there. Some of them munching away, not really minding about what's going on today. And if you look very carefully, you can actually see there's not a lot of grass growing on this area. Now, it's actually quite deceiving from when you're on the ground driving around. You don't get to always see these beautiful aerial views. And it's actually quite amazing. I'm trying to think. Eggsy, I was walking with David, I think, the other morning. We walked through this area. And it didn't look that bad, but there's actually some really sort of bald spots that you can see, especially around the pans, and that might be also where the animals have feasted the most, though. There they are, darting around, and that typically happens at watering holes as the vegetation disappears first, but it's not a lot of grass, and that's something we've seen even on the big open plains in front of DRC. It's these small little shrubs that unfortunately I don't think have too much nutrition. The elephants have been munching away on them, but I haven't really seen the impala feasting upon them. But maybe when they get desperate, they will start to eat on them. But isn't that just the most incredible view from the drone? And Connor, that you're doing an absolutely sterling job. And now you can really sort of see what the savannah is really all about, is that the savannah biome is basically these grasslands with these trees that grow in and amongst around them. Now, this isn't a particularly big open area, but it's a very, very, very typical of the savannah. And the trees that we normally see, you can see a marula tree, the bright green tree in the middle of the sort of the bottom of your screen, and then just to the right of it, which is where all the buffalo weaver nests are, is a big knobthorn. And those two trees seem to be the trees that are here or growing in this area. And then a couple of small gwari trees, the smaller ones, and around there. But other than that, there's of course, there's not, unfortunately, too much else than that. Now, James is apparently looking for Karula behind the dam wall. And wouldn't it be amazing if we were able to spot Karula, of course, from the air, just see her walking around? And that's something that this drone might be able to do, is that in the future we may be able to start spotting animals from like this, because you can actually see them quite easily. You can see the is that a wildebeest? I think it's a wildebeest in and amongst, there we go, sorry, a little bit difficult to see wildebeest with all the impala, and we might get lucky enough to see Karula walking across the dam wall. Now, I have something I have to show you, and I know a couple of you did guess. Now, I just wanted to double check, where is it? There it is there. So, Harry, you guessed a large toad. Brian, you said a leopard, and now I'm just quickly exiting all of this. And then, of course, James, Richard, and quite a few others of you all had a good guess. Megs, you also guessed correctly, and you all said elephants. That's exactly what these teeth are. And like I said, it's my favorite animal, and we've been chatting a lot about their teeth lately. Now, the Latin name for an elephant is Loxodonta africana, and probably one of my favorite names, as well as Apiceros melampus melampus, which is the impala's Latin name. I think it's just quite a nice one to say. And these Latin names are really good because they describe what's going on quite nicely. So, for example, the Latin name describes these teeth perfectly. Loxodonta africana sort of very loosely translates to long diamond-shaped tooth animal, and you can see that. You see that? The beautiful sort of, you have to use your imagination, of course, the diamond shapes in the teeth, and you can even see where they've started to wear down. Look at that. Almost nothing left. Not very good for grinding, unfortunately. And that's what would have been all the hard vegetation that they're eating, or even over time, all the grasses, as they're using their top and bottom molars grinding together, eventually completely grinding it so that it's so flat that there's nothing left. And once it reaches that point, like I say, it pushes up from the molars and moves forward and then pops out. And I'm not sure who found these elephant teeth, but this is very, very special, of course, to have out here. But sadly, that is all the time we have for you in the tent, and we'll see you tomorrow morning, of course, for the sunrise safari. I think I'll be out driving about, looking for all sorts of animals, and it's been wonderful, and I hope James finds Karula and sees and shows being able to show you a spotted cat. But let's go back across to Jamie now and see what she's up to.
So, well, it's Beagle. Now you've got me determined. Oh, never mind, it's been mobbed. And it's gone again. Drat. Okay, I give up. You win, Hawk Eagle, this time. I'll be back. I just thought it was such a beautiful evening. I must say, I'm feeling like a bit of an idiot with the roof on. This morning, I decided not to put a roof on and had to rush back to put the roof on because it rained. And this afternoon, I did the opposite. I was overly cautious, and now I feel a little bit silly because basically I just have an extra bit of shade and a slightly blocked view. Now, we will be going back to those lions because I think that Mfumo is going to roar for us at some point this evening. And that's what I'm hoping anyway. After the rain, perhaps the lions feeling a little bit more vocal. We saw one Birmingham boy going towards the southern section of Juma. And I think they might call between each other. He was, even this morning at 8 o'clock this morning, he was thinking about calling. Thinking about roaring, and after rain, all of the animals re-establishing their territorial markers. Now I'm just going for a little bit of a loop around, see what we can see. The clouds are beautiful. I think there's going to be a spectacular sunset. I can't wait. Okay, I know this is, I don't know, I wanted to show you this view. Okay, quick look at the view, because James has found you something with a heartbeat. Actually, never mind, my roof is in the way. I'm an idiot. You can't see the view, the roof is in the way. In that case, I think let's send you over to James with his monkeys.
Either that or it's a zombie monkey. Do you think it's a zombie monkey,
no,
Brian?
No.
Not? How do you know, though?
Because it's eating grass. Zombie monkeys eat brains only.
Eat other monkeys' brains, yes. Don't they? Yes, we know that. I should have remembered that from my training. Also, they don't have babies. Yeah. Zombies are infertile. So yes, it does have a heartbeat, everybody. A real heart-beating monkey with a pole in the way. Let me go a little bit forward. There we go. We've had all the primates today. More gorgeous light flowing down onto quarantine clearings. And we are going to go back to those cubs. We couldn't go straight away because there were already two vehicles there. And it's limited to a two-vehicle sighting when Mum is not around. Isn't that beautiful? Now, they will have a slightly different digestive system from those baboons because they don't eat meat. I mean, they'll eat insects, certainly, but they eat a lot more vegetation. Fresh grass, which means they must have some form of bacteria in their stomachs in order to digest it. They do eat leaves and shoots and buds, but it's a largely vegetarian diet. A bit like you now, Brian, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. There we go. Oh, and they're having such fun frolicking in this grass. Impala also around them, as you saw. And a tiny little baby monkey. Isn't that sweet? It's so peaceful out here at the moment. That's just gorgeous. Oh, look at that. And all of you apparently think this is very cute. It is very, very cute indeed. Tremendous. Fantastic, Brian. Astounding.
Absolutely incredible.
Your view's about to be blocked. Fantastic. Thank you, Mike. Now, before anyone gets confused by why that happened, it happened a big... No problem, Mike, you can't see anything with the roof on. The roof is on, and so he couldn't see which way the camera was pointing. I suppose he might have seen the monkeys, hey? Beautiful. An itchy bottom. A little baby suckling there, and the rest of the troop wandering around on the ground here, finding nice delicious things to eat for themselves. And then they will find a tall tree around here. They'll come towards a clearing like this, or go towards down towards the drainage line to find a tall tree to roost in for the evening. All right, let's go back. We don't have much time because we're not going to be around those cubs after sunset. So let's head straight back to them now. They're not far from where we are. Hello, Zaz. I'm trying to think about how to answer your question because you make a good point. You said, why don't we see monkeys more often? When we do see them relatively often, the baboons we don't see nearly as often as I would expect. I think that's because of a lack of roosting sites for them here. But the monkeys are around, you know. They're often in the camp, sitting on the roof, pilfering bits and pieces. And then they go, move along the drainage line areas. And so, yeah, we do see them. But they do a lot of movement in the middle of the day. And... yeah, I guess we're just not always around them, but there are quite a few of them around. Good evening. That looked like a small child driving the car. I learned to drive a car here. Now, Tormented Zombie Owl, you have some information for us. Thank you very much. Important information, this, on how it is that other monkeys become zombies. And as you say, it is when a zombie monkey bites another zombie another monkey, it then becomes a zombie. Do they actually eat anything though? Or do they not have to eat?
Zombies.
Yeah. The zombies don't have to eat, says Louise.
I don't know actually.
In your experience, in the zombies that you've met, do they eat?
No. Kind of aimlessly run around.
Yes, they aimlessly run around and bite things. Yes, and go... Yeah, I think that's what they do.
Yeah.
But a monkey zombie would go...
Not even a...
Oh, yes. What did a baboon zombie do, right? Right, we're at the leopards now, everybody. Nothing but a stony silence from the final control. I'm not entirely surprised. Apparently this is because Louise is narrating to Jamie what we're doing. I think that'd probably be even funnier. These two lazy lumps have not moved since we last saw them, which is deeply indicative of the fact that they've done a lot of eating lately. Hello, we're back again. Could you get up and do something interesting? let me try and move in here without destroying this rain cover and Brian, the zombie baboon. These, luckily everybody, are not zombie leopards, because you don't want to be around a zombie leopard, do you, Brian?
No.
I do find the fascination that people have with zombies quite astounding. Is that all right? There we go. Hello, Hosanna. Hello, Shungile. That is Hosanna. He's eyeing you out, Brian. I think he quite likes you. What's not to like? He is questioning your decision to not eat meat, though, however. He thinks he wouldn't ever be able to live without meat. He is, of course, correct. Vegetarian leopards tend not to survive. I've just heard, everyone, I've just heard all the way from Chitwa Chitwa Dam, a hippopotamus. Isn't that cool? Not a zombie hippopotamus. Oh, that's so sweet. He does look a little bit zombie-ish with his eyes open like that, doesn't he? Shongile, much more responsible, lying in cover, where it's highly unlikely anything would see her, while her brother lies out in the open with not a care in the world, knowing that his mother will provide for him for at least the next year or so. Ooh. I heard a stick breaking. Graham, you're wondering about leopard territory size, basically, although you're not asking that directly. You're saying, what sort of area do they cover to hunt? The size of their territory is entirely dependent on their, or the amount of prey that there is, and therefore their territory size is a very good indicator of how much ground they cover when they're trying to catch something. So, A leopardess in this area has an area of about 15 square kilometers, maybe up to 25 square kilometers, but 15 probably is about right, and that is roughly 1,500 hectares or so, which is in turn about 3,200 acres. That's about the size of Karula's territory. It's pretty big for a leopardess in this area. Down towards the Sand River, they get a bit smaller than that, and probably cover around about 1,000 hectares, or 2,500 hectares, acres, sorry. What would that be? Yeah, that's about accurate for Karula. So, I mean, Juma, for example, the reserve we're on is 1,200 hectares. No other leopardess uses this particular property. It's only her. And Shadow uses the eastern sides, western sides, every so often. But Karula also extends into Biffles Hook sometimes, into Torchwood, and then down south, of course, into Chitwa, and Little Gowrie, and Hoffman's. There's quite a big area. So the more prey there is, obviously, the smaller the area that they live in. And that's why in a place like the Middle East, where leopards do exist, their territories will be 4 or 5 times, 10 times that size sometimes. Otherwise, everything is completely at peace here. And I think the reason they haven't moved or played is because they're full of meat that they're trying to digest. Whatever hapless creature had its guts ripped out by their mother, that Herbert found, and he showed me, in the little pan near Twin Dams, whatever that creature was has been eaten and is now currently passing through the carnivorous digestive system that you can see working frantically there. There's also a fly there, Brian, you see that? Gorgeous. It must be quite a brave decision, don't you think, to become a biologist and specialize in flies. What do you think you say at a cocktail party? Good evening. Hello. What do you do? Oh, I'm a fly biologist. A what? A fly biologist. Oh. Well, I'll see you later then. Not quite the same as saying I'm a spy. Or a zombie.
Do you give out zombie business cards?
No, I think you just bite people in the neck. Anyway, I don't think we're going to spend too much longer here. These chaps are not doing a huge amount. I don't think they're likely to. Winter Prism, you are being thoroughly amusing this evening. You say leopards do live on a vegetarian diet. All they eat is vegetarians. That's not actually true. They also eat, in fact, of all the predators out here, Winter Prism, and I take your meaning, but of all the predators out here, they are the ones that eat other predators the most. They will very happily hunt civets and genets and jackals. We know that they hunt domestic dogs in many parts of the world, including here, when they happen to stray onto this reserve. And so they eat other carnivores quite enthusiastically. They also eat fish, catfish specifically, quite often, frogs, insects if they have to. Right, the sun is beginning to set, and that means we must leave these chaps on their own, because Mum is not here to be with them. And given that they are, well, we'll just let him roll around and lick his hands, and then we'll head out of here, I think. Shongile has gone flat cat entirely now. Maybe we can pop down towards Treehouse Dam and see if anything's going on there. See if maybe the Salala pride has come back. God. Well, that was nice, Brian, wasn't it? Yes. Goodbye, Hosanna. Jack, you want to know about Brian's favourite animal. Brian, over to you.
My favourite animal is a warthog.
A warthog?
A warthog.
Not a lion? Or an elephant? Or a buffalo?
These are nice.
Or a giraffe?
These are nice, but warthog's number one.
But pigs are the number one. Well, Brian, do you remember we saw some pigs down here just earlier today? Let's see if we can re-find them. I must say, I think that's quite a good choice. Warthogs are the favourite of a number of people. One can but remember the squealing that used to take place on the radio when Tara Dales was directing. Sorry, there was a great explosion in my ear that I'm going to have to deal with, because if it happens again, I'm going to get a big fright. Very odd. Oh, I know what it is. Now, the warthog burrow, or the warthogs with their little babies, were just around here, and then they ran away. I'm sure they live in that termite mound there. That one, yes. Alas, no piggies. Right, Jamie Patterson has found herself a high point, and from there she would like to show you the world.
I told you that this evening is truly spectacular, and I wanted to show you the view earlier, but I didn't manage on account of the fact that there was a roof in the way. So I thought we'd just stop for a second and take in the spectacular scenery of these clouds, complete with a little window of light shining down upon Juma. The sounds of the birds chirping. Mainly just the kingfishers. But it is still really, really beautiful. Franklin's joining in. Spurfowl, actually. Natal Spurfowl joining in with their raucous shouting. The kingfishers. Chick-chirr. What would a zombie kingfisher sound like? Oh, I've lost it. I don't know how they got talking about zombie brains and zombie monkeys and zombie things. I can tell you though that I think that lions would be the most terrifying. Zombie lions or possibly zombie hyenas. Zombie hyenas would be really scary. Zombie woodland kingfisher. I'm just going to see if... No, I don't think it's going to work. I was going to try and change the angle of the vehicle for the roof. Just for one last glimpse. Now, I'm sure you're all eager to get a slightly different perspective on this beautiful sunset. Let's have a look at it from the skies. Just look at that. Wow, Connor. Whoa. That's awesome. Flying over the waterhole. You see the Inyalas. Now you can see us on your screens. Hello, everybody. That was a seriously impressive feat of flying from Connor. Absolutely magnificent. He's showing you the sunset. My goodness gracious, he nearly hit the tree. this exquisite scenery that you're looking at. Oh, it is beautiful. Those massive clouds as the cold, rainy front blows away. And you can see how the face of the vegetation has changed completely. Now, it's a pity we couldn't... Well, not a pity, actually, but it's sort of a pity that we didn't see things from the air during the height of the drought. But I cannot believe how the vegetation has changed and how much thicker everything has gotten. Everything's bright and beautiful green, particularly in this stunning evening light. There's a cool breeze blowing. It hasn't been too hot. It hasn't been too cold. And I'm hoping I'm hoping that this is the end of our drought. You can see the velvet-like green of the grass and then the roads cutting through it. Gives you a really, really lovely perspective as to just how vast this wilderness area is that we get to drive around in. And we might get a portion of it, but it's still a portion of a really, truly massive whole. And there's no fences to bar the animals. They can go where they want, when they want, well, apart from other animals. And that's the truly magnificent thing about being out here. That was so cool. I thought for 1 second that perhaps Connor might actually crash the drone into the tree. That would have been utterly tragic, but I should have known better. Connor is a truly accomplished drone pilot. So there you go, a beautiful scene from high. Oh my goodness, these clouds just get better. Hold on, I don't think Rian can see from where he is. But I'm going to try and get you one last view of just the sun shining through. I know the roof's in the way, I'm so sorry, but maybe if we just zoom in ever so slightly, there you go, look at that. How spectacular is that? Really, truly, we are spoilt with views like this. And always accompanied by the sound of the trilling kingfishers. Oh, that's beautiful. Wow. Okay, as much as I would love to linger looking at the sun setting means that the lions are going to start thinking about getting up, which means that we need to start moving in that direction, which is what we're going to do. And I apologize for my inability to say the letters B, P, D, and actually L for some reason I'm struggling with. And G. G's a really hard one to say with a blocked nose. Right, let's go find those lions. It's not so much finding them as just go back to where I left them before it does start to get too late. And keeping an eye out, of course, for the Queen of Karula. But I am very, very curious to see what our zombie expert has to say about the woodland kingfisher zombie call. So let's go back across to him so he can tell you.
That's what they do,
yep.
Obviously. Right, we're going up now towards the... We went to Treehouse Dam. We did find some primates there. They were having a gin and tonic, so we left them. And we are now heading down towards my favorite viewpoint on the Jamar to see if we too can get a nice view of this relatively, quite astounding cloud formation. And, then we'll make a plan after that, I suppose. I've just been somewhat overcome by the gorgeousness of the afternoon. I've had a few afternoons like that of late, especially ones when the clouds are rolling in and diffusing the light. I think this thing is bringing with it quite a lot of moisture, however. What do you say, Brian? Luckily, we've got sandbags and other paraphernalia to save us from the deluge when it begins. I'm always a bit sad at this time of the year when I drive past the marulas with their mistletoes in them. Of course, the mistletoe is a very much Christmassy type of a plant, and Christmas is over for another year. Always makes me a little bit sad. Boo-hoo. Oh, and I was asked today in the tent, I forget exactly who asked me, whether or not I'd listened to all the Boney M that you had so kindly, at the behest of Brent Leo Smith, posted on my Facebook wall. I can comfortably tell you I didn't listen to one. So thank you very much, and I'm sorry Brent wasted your time. Behold, the apocalypse. Do you think that's the apocalypse, Brian?
No.
Not?
Not yet, anyway.
Not just yet.
Not just yet.
Okay.
Soon.
Soon. Right, a wonderful question from somebody called Recon Panda. Well, Recon Panda, you say, how hot does it get here? Recon Panda, the hottest it probably gets is around 40 degrees Celsius, up to, I suppose, 45 on some days, and 45 degrees Celsius, if I'm not mistaken, sits at about 110 degrees Fahrenheit. That is very unusual. It doesn't happen frequently at all. But that's the hottest it'll get. And that can be normally in December. January and February are hot, but they're not, because every or many of the afternoons these clouds come rolling in, they tend to cool down a little bit. I think the hottest or the most uncomfortable month is probably November, just before the rains, when you just get heat and no relief from it at all. And that, of course, during our drought last year, persisted from September all the way through to March. It was just hot with no rain. Very gorgeous, Brian. Positively artistic. Now, apparently, Jamie Patterson has managed to trump us, and that is because she isn't a zombie like us.
No.
Let's go and find out what it is.
Well, fortunately, I managed to escape the zombie madness that appears to have descended. I am, however, utterly, utterly astounded by the beauty of this afternoon sky. This is really, truly spectacular. And I know we're rushing to the lions, and we will rush to the lions. Mike from Cheetah Plains has just let me know that they are still there and they're not moving. So we're not going to neglect to show you this incredible view. Oh, my word. Those beams of light coming through the gap in the clouds. It's the kind of stuff paintings are made of, or inspired by, or jigsaw puzzles. Oh, spectacular. Okay, should we get to these lions? How much time have we got left? Half an hour, yes, we better get to those lions. My plan was always to spend at least sort of the last half an hour with them, but I just had to show you that view. I'm so disappointed I didn't get to hear what the zombie kingfisher sounds like. You're all fortunate in that you got to enjoy that. I missed out on it. We should just start throwing random varieties of animal for James to do their zombie call. I'm not quite sure how you could play with the call of a spotted hyena and zombify it. It's pretty zombie-like in its own, it's pretty eerie in its own way. Woo! Alrighty, well, Connor has both James and myself beaten with a view of the clouds. Let's go and see things from his perspective.
Oh. Well, it's not really ours, of course. This is Connor's view of the sky. You're looking out east at the moment and swinging, I believe, to the south. An astounding view of the burgeoning storm. And there we are. That is the south, and you can see the rain falling down there. Isn't that marvellous? A 100 different colours of grey, far more than the 50 that well, shall we say, writer wrote about, and we're now swinging towards the golden sunlight streaming through the storm. I just think it's rather marvellous to be able to look at the wilderness like this, and apparently there's a bird flying around the drone. I wonder what kind of bird it is. Connor got some wonderful stuff of vultures yesterday, and vultures, of course, not being attack birds, are not likely to hit the drone, which is fantastic. Isn't that beautiful? And we're going to do a little Safari Live story about the drone fairly soon. And the point of this drone, of course, is not only because it's a fun thing to fly and new technology is good to have. It really does give you, the viewer, a new perspective on things. So when we talk about the expanse of the Kruger Park, or how far away the mountains are, or the storms coming in from the south, at least now you can see exactly what we're seeing in the same sort of perspective. Isn't that special? I always think that it's the best view that we can have out here. It makes me feel a deep sense of peace and well-being. And we're lucky we got Connor out at all today, because there was quite a lot of rain earlier, and that nearly put pay to his coming out. Gorgeous. Connor, of course, is now deeply satisfied with himself on account of the fact that he is part of the show. And we were discussing how many feeds we have and how many we were going to have today. And we said, well, we'll have three feeds because we'll have two vehicles in the tent, because we don't want to send the walk out at the moment because of these little squalls that have been coming through, and they'll cook the walking pack. And Connor said, when do I become a feed too? He looked a little bit hurt, of course. And the answer to him was, well, when you're prepared to start narrating what you're seeing. And he went very quiet after that. He's not a sort of, he doesn't wish to hog the camera like some of us. Now, we're going into the west of Juma, just on the off chance that there's something in the clearing here. Louise says I'm a camera zombie, which I suppose today is absolutely correct. And we've had such nice sightings in the clearings today, so we're going to head to one more, and that is Impala Plains, and see if there's anything there. Then we're going to start making our way towards home, because we have an interesting thing after drive today. Ah, you see. And I have to agree with you. I'll get back to what I was saying just now. You say it's these beautiful skies and deep skies that keep you coming to Kruger again and again and again and again. Well, for me, it's the same thing. Yes, absolutely, I love watching the animals and seeing them and interacting with them and enjoying what their antics and their stories. But it's, for me, it's the environment. It's the trees and the sky, and the fact that I can watch a pollution-free sunset every single day and the same sunrise every single day that keeps me living out here. And I understand entirely what you mean. Now, at 7 o'clock, so right at the end of the drive, we're going to try something through Periscope. And Periscope, if you don't know, is Twitter's sort of live video thing. So where Facebook has Facebook Live, Periscope is the Twitter equivalent. And we're going to do it via, it's going to be a virtual reality one. So if you've got those goggles and things, well, you can get in on the goggles and you can watch us that way. Otherwise, so what the camera will do is it'll sit like that, and we'll be able to walk around it like that, and you can do it on your phone or your iPad if you like, and you can either move the screen around, which I find deeply irritating, or you can just watch it and scroll. So you can move it with your finger. So if you're watching a virtual reality video on your iPad or your phone, you can just move with your finger up or down, and the picture will tilt all around. So it won't just be, well, it will be two-dimensional, but it'll be all the way around. So we'll do that at 7 o'clock, see if it works. Oh, and this one, apparently you can also zoom in. So if I am sitting, we're going to do it from the camp, Brian and I. We'll sit either side of it and see what happens. You can probably zoom in to one of us, or you could probably zoom into whatever else is going on around us. It might be Jerry's room, for example. You could zoom in there. and it is fully interactive, which means that you can comment on the Periscope feed. Luisi will feed through the question to my ear and I will answer it, or Brian will answer it. So we're just going to see what happens. 10 minutes it should be. And I mean, live VR or live virtual reality is, well, it's unusual. There's no one doing it at the moment, I don't think. So that's what we're going to be doing. Right, this is a very difficult part of the road to negotiate, everybody. Big speed humps. I don't want to make you sick. Jamie Patterson is not alone any longer.
While James navigates his tricky patch of road and doesn't make you all motion sick, our lion cubs are very, very still. And I guess they've tuckered themselves out after an afternoon spent with very boisterous play. Just realised there's another male lion behind there. It looks like a little bit to the right, Rion. There. There's two male lions, so Tinio is still with the Nkuhumas. I wasn't 100% sure whether or not he was still around, but he is in fact still here. Hello, boy. It's lovely to see you. I can only count three lionesses, two males, and six cubs. And Echo, you wanted to know whether or not lions ever have problems with things like grass seeds or thorns getting stuck in their feet. They do occasionally get thorns, particularly between the pads of their toes. They can get thorns stuck in there. For the most part, they're quite good at pulling them out, but it does happen. Generally, the sort of the worst injuries with lions tend to be some from something like hunting rather than grass seeds or thorns. You might see them worrying at their feet a little bit, but as you can see, this lioness has got something far nastier to worry about on her shoulder. So we've seen this wound over the last few days. We've been looking at it. She's got a puncture wound on her shoulder. It looks as though it's still open. It's not weeping as much as it was. Okay, for those of you that are a bit squeamish, don't look at the moment. We're just going to have a slightly closer look at it. That's very much a puncture, but that could have come from a buffalo horn or a lion. It's hard to say for sure. So those are the really serious injuries. You do occasionally get lions that actually ultimately become very badly disadvantaged by a thorn in the foot, because essentially what will happen is it can become infected if that thorn gets stuck there. And if the lion doesn't manage to get it out, or to push, if its body doesn't manage to push it out with white blood cells and with pus around the thorn itself, then the lion can end up with a really, really nasty injury. But that's quite unusual. As you can imagine, their feet are tough, and it's only really between the toes that their feet are at their most vulnerable. Far more common in terms of injuries to their feet will be injuries to their claws, particularly if they've come into conflict with each other. Scratching or clawing in any way, if their claw gets hooked in another individual, it might pull it out. And that can be a very, very uncomfortable injury indeed. Oh, Peggy on. There you go. Giving us an example of the feet cleaning. Getting right in between the toes there. Giving us a lovely little glimpse of those razor-sharp paws. You definitely wouldn't want to play with lion cubs of this age. I promise you, they would tear you to shreds. Even if they weren't actually... I mean, obviously, we don't play with lion cubs. That's not on. But if, in a fantasy world, you were to play with them, I can imagine they would do some serious damage with those sharp claws. Annabelle, while we look at one of our dominant males, you want to know when lions start spraying and scent marking. They will only really start to spray in scent mark or to use it as a scent mark once they start to try and establish themselves in a territory. And that depends upon the age of the lion, of course, but it'll also depend on the number of males. So the Birmingham boys, when they came in, there were four of them, which made them a very seriously strong force to be reckoned with. Sorry, there were five of them. Correction, there were five of them, which was gave them a serious advantage of numbers. So when they came in, they were quite young, and they started scent marking at about 4 years old. There is Fleming grimacing. Sorry, the male. He's testing the scent of the female, and then doing what's known as the Fleming grimace. In other words, bringing in the scent up to the vomeral nasal organ that sits at the roof of the mouth, that essentially allows him to taste the smell that he's smelling. So they can start young if they establish a territory, but they could end up only establishing, if they ever do, there he's doing it again. They might only end up establishing a territory when if there's only one or two of them at around 6 years old, if ever, and only then will they start to scent mark. Oh, another big yawn. And that's usually a precursor to getting up and moving, which the male seems keen on doing, intent on doing. Now, the last time I saw these lions, Mfumo and Amber Eyes were mating with each other. I'm not quite sure what's happened in the dynamics. I'm not even sure where Amber Eyes is at this point in time, with which lioness is with him. Now, we were speaking about lions, male lions, scent marking. Lionesses can start a little bit earlier with their scent marking because, of course, the lionesses will stay as part of the pride, so they'll be responsible for protecting the pride's territory. Right, it is time for James to say farewell to you all. Let's go over to him so that he can do that.
I nearly did a zombie farewell, but I decided against it. I'm sure you've noticed, but as Jamie was linking there, the wind has come up, and obviously this is the storm blowing in. So we're going to head back to camp, set up the virtual reality rig, and I will see you at about 7 o'clock. Now, you have to go to Periscope. If you don't have Periscope, it's an app that you can download, I'm sure, from Google Play or from, what's the other one called, the App Store? Oh, there, Microsoft's also got one. You know what device you've got. You know where you get your apps. Periscope belongs to Twitter. And this will be a virtual reality show, and I will explain while we're doing it how to watch it. But basically what you do, you take your device, if you don't have the goggles, and if you've got the goggles then you can just look around the place, but if you don't have the goggles, you take your device and you put your finger on your device and you push up or down and sideways, and then you can watch it. Otherwise you can move the device, but it'll get very irritating when you want to look behind you. I've tried it myself and flung a phone through the window in irritation. So that's the story there, and it will begin at 1900 hours sharp, we hope. If it doesn't, just keep watching. Okay, all right, that's going to be it from us. We're going to hie our way home. Thank you, Brian, for your efforts. Marvelous time today on the zombie drive. Show us your it's not a zombie thumb though, is it? Okay, right, well, from the two zombies, we'll see you shortly in virtual reality.
So while our zombie crew stumbles or shuffles their way home, in my imagination to the tune of Thriller, we are still with our Nkuhumas, who are showing every sign of getting up. So one lioness got up to go into the cubs. Oh, I love watching the affection between the lionesses and their cubs. It's always invariably heartwarming to see. Time for a quick bath, get to those hard-to-reach spots behind the ears and on the shoulders, places where the cub can't get to itself. And of course, that will also help with the itching. Oh, got its ear in her mouth. Useful tree branch to keep it propped up when its muscles have gone all tired and weak from Mom's bath and attention. Now she's just gently nibbling on him. There's been some low rumbling from Tino at the back. He seems to be a bit growly this afternoon. I'm not sure if it's him. I'm actually not sure if it's him growling or if he's upset him for more in some way, or if it's just the females warning him not to come too much closer. I'm trying to work out where the rest of the lionesses are. I've counted three, four, I think. I think I've counted four of them. Not quite sure where the fifth is, but she could easily just be hiding behind the thick branches. There's the female from earlier, stopping to have a jolly good scratch. She's also been licking her paws and stretching herself up. Oh, there's some serious complaining happening from the cub that's getting the bath. It's now making a lot of noise. Oh, well, Mom gives them a jolly good clean and our lions show every sign of getting active. Recon Panda, you want to know how long a lion, male lion, will sleep for? How often does he need to sleep? During the day, they can sleep for a very, very long time, quite contentedly. And lions have been known and often do sleep for up to 22 hours a day. 20 to 22 hours if they have a meal and a handy female. But that doesn't make them lazy. For one thing, male lions overheat far easier than female lions because they're that much heavier, that much bigger. Male lions also have a very, very important job to do in terms of patrolling a territory, and that can take them on enormously long walks in order to go and roar, scent mark. It's quite a taxing business being a dominant male of an area. So they could spend hours and hours in the night walking around and patrolling, which is probably what Tino and Mfumo might do, although it depends very much on whether this female in Estrus, Amber Eyes, is still around, which I would assume she is. I know she was seen this morning. The cubs have all been woken up by loving moms. And you can see the lioness with the injury on her shoulder isn't limping in any way, so it's not too serious at all. It's basically just a flesh wound. I'm sure it's not comfortable, but it will heal up nicely. Squeeze under Mom's belly. Everybody's awake now. Time to gather up the cubs and quite possibly get moving. You can see from the flap of skin underneath that lioness's belly that she is hungry. She could really use a meal, as could all of them, I'm sure. She's kept her cubs well fed. Oh, flop. In this way. There we go. Settling down to have some energy refueling. A warm welcome to Graham, who would like to know a little bit more about the lion population in the Kruger and its surroundings, and whether or not specifically it is increasing or decreasing in the Kruger. So at the moment, you'll probably find that lion population is going to do a little bit of an increase. You'll find that the Kruger has been, the Kruger National Park, the sort of the core centre of it, has been in operation for, as a tourist destination, for 90 years, but for as a reserve, close to over 100 years. So the lion population had achieved a sort of relative stasis, but then of course it got expanded. The Great Kruger National Park was expanded. Fences were dropped between the Sabi Sands, the Timbavati, the Baluli areas. So that automatically changed the lion dynamics, and for a while things were in a constant state of flux. Now, however, that was a good 20 years ago at the sort of latest that the Kruger was expanded. Now the lion dynamics have stabilized, but you find that they always will do little ups and downs. The population will always do little ups and downs throughout the years. So at the moment you'll probably find that after the drought, the lion population might increase slightly because there's been so much more food around and hunting has been so much easier for the lions. They haven't needed to struggle at all. And of course that's oversimplification, because there's all kinds of other factors, as we've seen with the white muscle disease and with the mange that they've had. There are other factors as well, but you'll probably find, as a sort of basic net value, the lion's population has increased ever so slightly in the Kruger. And it might show a dip after. That nature has a way, wonderful way, of balancing things, and we don't want too many lions wandering about, because of course Satara, which is not too far away from where we are now, one of the rest camps in Kruger, that has one of the largest lion concentrations in the world, the largest lion concentration in the world, highest density of lions. You don't want too many lions around, because obviously we want lions around, but not too many, because they will then damage the population of wild dogs, cheetahs, leopards, and other predators that are in competition with them, as well as, of course, affecting the balance of prey numbers. Are you having a great game, you two? So nature has a way of balancing populations out, and you'll probably find they fluctuate, but not a huge amount. Welcome to Jason, who is one of our newer viewers, and was wondering, well, if the lions are hungry, why don't they attack the people in the safari vehicles? Or do they? The answer to that is they don't see us as food at all. They've become very used to the presence of vehicles, but they don't view it as, their instinct tells them what they can eat, but they don't view people as food. So they know that buffalo is food, they know that antelope is food. They do not see a vehicle as a sort of moving lunchbox, so to speak, packed full with juicy humans. So they very, very, very seldom jump into the vehicles. It does happen on occasion. It's incredibly rare. And by rare, I mean you've got a greater chance of dying in a plane accident than being attacked by a lion on safari. And it's only really when that animal is really sick or old or desperate that a big cat will try and attack somebody in a safari vehicle. Perhaps you've seen some videos on YouTube, Jason, of lions attacking people in vehicles. That is when those lions have been hand-raised and they have been fed from the back of vehicles, so they've come to associate the vehicle with food. With us driving around like this, they don't associate us with food at all. If we were to go for a walk now, they would get up and run away, because they see human beings. Thousands of years of evolution have taught them that human beings standing upright are a danger. Because, of course, we were at one point, and probably, I suppose, still are, one of the apex predators of this area. Oh, big yawn. Even though we no longer hunt here or do anything like that. But lions view us during the day as a threat. At night, if I were to walk up to them, they'd eat me. It's quite simple. It's as simple as that. Lions know instinctively that at night they are the dominant predator of this area. And that's why it's always so wonderful watching lions at night, because that's where they really truly come into their own. Look at her snarling, grabbing the cub. Little fusspot. I'm not sure that this lioness is lactating. This one definitely is. We saw her feeding the cubs earlier. It's the same lioness that was feeding the other cubs earlier. And I think she might be the last lioness that's still lactating. The others don't seem terribly keen on the whole process. See? She's not having it. Hey, don't put on your mom's beard. That's rude. And she won't like it. I'll just stand on her face, why don't you? These poor mothers are so patient and so tolerant of these constantly niggling, attention-seeking little cubs. It's wonderful to see. Flop. Over goes the cub, still trying to suckle. It's not going to happen, little bun. Your mom is not interested, no matter how much you try and placate her with loving licks. She doesn't want to suckle. She doesn't want to let you suckle. Yep, she's going to lie on you. Aha. Trapped now. It's so sweet. Well, our lions didn't roar, but they did give us a really lovely view into their family life. Big hug? Big hug, sort of. Not a very affectionate hug. Hugs with teeth and claws still count as hugs. Administering the death bite. Oh my goodness, it seems as though we have actually reached the 1 minute stage and it's time to do our goodbyes already, which is most tragic. I hadn't realized how fast the time had passed. And it is time for us to do a big goodbye and a thank you to all of you. So a big thank you to Rion for his wonderful camera work. A big thank you to Lou and to Kirsty at Final Control. Most importantly, a big thank you to all of you for putting up with our ridiculousness, sending through your questions and your comments, and for just all in all keeping us company. Tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari, we will be trying to follow up on the Nkuhumas, trying to figure out where they have gone and what they've been up to, and perhaps even try and see whether or not they've made a kill, and of course search for the Queen of Juba herself. We'll see you on the Sunrise Safari. Bye-bye, everybody, and have an absolutely wonderful day wherever you happen to be.